Good morning and welcome. So glad that you're here with us. Y'all give it up for our pit crew up here, man. They did an awesome job getting that in there that quick. Hey, would you guys, just for a sec, would you let our drama team know how awesome they did this morning? They did an amazing job. Amen. They have been working tirelessly, practice after practice, Saturday, Sundays. Parents, I thank you for waiting in your car for hours on end for them to be out of practice. But they did an amazing job. And just the words to that song, you know, to strike the ground for revival has so much meaning in what we're talking about inside of our Guardrail series. Because revival in its simplest form is just a change. It's a change in behavior. It's a change in the way we see things, a change in our culture. And so when we talk about guardrails, it's putting up guardrails in our lives so that we can make a change in the direction that God wants us to go. So I just think it was awesome to be able to see that this morning. Hey, let me start off by letting you guys know my name's Chris. If you haven't been here, I'm one of the pastors on staff, and today I get the privilege to be able to open the Word of God with you and kind of share. And we're going to be concluding this guardrail series. So if you have been here for the past 5 weeks and you're like, when are they going to stop talking about guardrails? Today is the day, okay? Today is the last day we're going to talk about it. But we have something very important to share with you. And if you haven't been here over the past few weeks, I just want to kind of recap just a little bit about what we are talking about. And so we have decided to take a physical guardrail and kind of look at what it does inside of our life if we had apply a spiritual principle to it. And so we know that a guardrail, by definition, is a system that is designed to keep vehicles from straying into dangerous or off-limit places. So when we see a guardrail, we know that that means we're not supposed to go past it or around it. That's to keep us on the right path, on the road. We know that guardrails are designed to direct us and protect us. And so they direct us in the direction. They also keep us from the danger zone. They keep us from a place that is unsafe. And so we know that guardrails are not placed inside the danger zone, but are placed in the safety zone. And so these are some things that we know. And so we've looked over the past few weeks at guardrails inside of our marriage, inside of our finances, inside of relationships and friendships, and how God wants us to build those guardrails so that we can look more like Him in the life that we live. And so we've kind of come up with a different definition of what a guardrail is. So a guardrail during this series is a personal standard of behavior that becomes a matter of conscience. Let me say that again, because this is very important. If you're taking notes, this is something that you need to write down. A guardrail is a personal standard of behavior that becomes a matter of conscience. Now, why do we say it's a personal standard of behavior? Because we believe that if you're only putting up guardrails in your life because Pastor Aaron told you or because I told you, then you're not going to truly make a change in your life, because you're not doing it for a personal reason. You're not bought into it. You're doing it for somebody else. And so we believe it needs to be a personal standard of behavior, and so it will become a matter of conscience. So we also have learned that culture in the world that we live in, what do? They don't encourage us to build guardrails, right? They encourage us to have painted lines. So a painted line, you can cross over and you never really know that you crossed over it. And so the culture that we live in encourages us to have painted lines. And they actually bait us to the edge with all of these temptations to get us to the point of crashing. And then when we crash, what do? They mock us, they turn their back on us, and they don't want anything to do with us. And that's the culture that we live in. For example, they will bait you with saying, hey, you need this in your life. You gotta buy this, you gotta have this. And so we go and we buy and we buy and we buy. And where do we find ourselves? We find ourselves in debt. We find ourselves in a place where maybe we have foreclosures, maybe we have repossessions, because we bought into that trap that culture set for us. And all of a sudden, we find ourselves in the danger zone. And so we know that culture baits us to the edge, and then they mock us when we go over the edge. And so that's all the recap that I'm going to kind of give today. And so if you haven't been here and you want to kind of keep up or catch up with these services, I want to encourage you to go to our YouTube channel. You can find all of those there in a series. You can share them with your friends. It's a great way to kind of be connected with the series and know where it is that we're at. And so today I want to spend some time talking about the big pushbacks to this whole series. And so a lot of us, we've been sitting through this, and maybe you've heard them, and you say things like, you know what, that's common sense. That makes a lot of sense. That's great. And so these are some of the pushbacks I think that we get when we look at guardrails inside of our life. One is this, that it is really good for everyone else in my life. It's really good for everyone else in my life. You say, you know what? This series is awesome. I'm going to send it to my aunt because she really needs help with her finances, and this would just be great for her. Or maybe there's a coworker that we know that's been going through a lot in their marriage, and we go, you know what? This is great for them. I'm going to send them this message on marriage and putting up guardrails in their life because I think this could really help them. And so we decide that it's good for everyone else, but maybe it's just not for us. The second thing I think that we do, and this is a big one, and when I say this, a lot of you are going to think to yourself, well, that's not me, but let's really evaluate this. I think the other way that we view it is this, that this all makes sense, but I'm just not going to do it. It all makes sense, but I'm not going to do it. The reality is I'm going to walk out of this place after this series is over. I'm going to do everything I've always done the same way I've always done it because I don't want to make those changes in my life. I'm comfortable with where I'm at. Nothing seems to be going wrong. I'm going to consistently stay with where I'm at. And so we say, I'm not going to do it. You see, the problem with a guardrail is that it keeps us from something we want. That's how we view it. The guardrail keeps us from something we want. So instead of saving and giving and say, I don't want to give. I want to buy. I want the newest iPhone. I want the newest gadget. I want the newest car. I want that. I don't want to give. See, it's not our natural tendency to have a desire to give. That's a guardrail that we put in our life. And we say, this is something that we need to do. So we say, you know what? I don't want to give, I want to buy. Or maybe we say, I don't want to be responsible because I really like that guy. I know he's toxic for me. I know it's bad and he's not the greatest influence, but he's really cute and I really want to spend time with him. So I'm going to make the decision to be in that relationship. And guys in the room, maybe you're sitting there going, you know what? I know it's not good for me to be in this relationship. I know that I shouldn't be with her because I know she's making wrong decisions in her life. And I know that it's not healthy for me, but I really don't want to be responsible. I just want to date him or date her. You see, guardrails seem to be in our way. And so the pushback and the truth is that a lot of us will look and weigh the options and decide, I don't really want to give up what I want. I just want to continue to do what I'm doing and continue to get to the things that I'm desiring inside of my life. See, because some of us believe that if we have a guardrail, that that's where the tension is in our life. Then when we put a guardrail, there comes tension. And that if we don't have guardrails, there's no tension. We don't have to worry about it. We can do what we want. There's no tension in our life. So we convince ourselves that that's the truth. But I believe that regardless of whether you have guardrails or not, the tension is not going away. Regardless of whether you put these guardrails up or not in your life, the tension doesn't go away. You see, all the tension does is it moves farther into the danger zone because at some point in your life, you're going to have to put the brakes on. You're going to have to put the brakes on. You're going to have to draw a line in the sand. All of us have a moral compass, and at some point we go, nope, I'm not crossing that line. At some point, we put the brakes on inside of our life. And when we do that, that becomes the point of tension. You see, not putting up the guardrails does not eliminate the tension. It only erodes your resolve and determines that whether you put the brakes on, it will be harder to come back from. See, it erodes your resolve. It takes away your ability to say no. And so it gets you closer to a point where you can no longer say, I don't want to do that. I don't want to do that. It makes it so much harder. You see, a guardrail in the safety zone keeps us from getting to that place inside of our life, whether it's our marriage or our finances or relationships. That's what the guardrail does. And see, we want to believe that that tension goes away, but it doesn't. It just moves farther into the danger zone. You see, the farther that you are into the situation, the more dangerous it will become. It only moves the battle line closer to disaster. See, at some point, you're going to have to fight. And all you're doing when you take away guardrails in your life is getting closer to a point that you can't come back from or to where it's harder to do. You see, another way to view this is to say that your appetite is never satisfied. Your appetite is never satisfied. You see, the more that you eat, we know this as human, the more that we eat, our bodies actually become more hungry because we set ourselves up to just want more and want more. You see, our appetite never ends. We always want more. The Bible tells us this in Proverbs 27:20. It says that hell and destruction are never full, so the eyes of man are never satisfied. See, there's never going to be enough. See, you're never going to get to a point where you don't want something else. You're always going to want something more. There's always going to be a tension point in your life. So say if you want to lease a car and you want to lease a new car and you know the guardrail is you shouldn't go into debt because you really can't afford it, but you decide to lease the new car, what happens? Nothing. You lease the new car, right? But all that's happened, the tension didn't go away. You just moved it because now in 18 months or 24 months or 48 months, what's going to happen? You're going to want to lease another new car. See, all we do is we move it closer into a danger zone until we get to a place where it's harder for us to come back from. I want to give you an example of this because seeing things with my eyes helped me, and so I'm thinking it will help you. And so a few weeks ago, we were talking about marriage and our guardrails, and we were talking about putting those up inside of our relationships. And one of the guardrails we talked about was saying that we need to make sure that we are maybe, when we're married, not going out with someone of the opposite sex, not going to grab coffee with someone of the opposite sex in order to build a guardrail in your marriage to say, I don't want to go there. I don't want to do that. I don't want to set up for what could possibly happen. And so here's kind of an analogy of the way I want to look at it. So this styrofoam cup here, this is us. So everybody, this is our attractive selves. And so when we decide and we're married and we're inside this relationship and we decide, you know what, I'm going to go grab coffee with someone at work of the opposite sex. I'm going to go do that. What happens when we go to grab coffee? Nothing, right? We're fine. Nothing happened. We're perfectly okay. No, nobody got hurt. We just went and grabbed coffee. And so then we realized, well, coffee went well. And the other person's like, well, do you want to grab dinner sometime? Maybe we could grab some dinner after work. You're like, well, you know what? Coffee went really well. Nothing really bad happened. And so, you know what? Maybe we'll go grab some dinner. We'll go grab dinner. Dinner's a good idea. So we go grab dinner. Now, many of you are looking at this. You're like, this is a really strong cup, right? So all of a sudden, like we've gotten dinner. We've had coffee. Well, then we continue to try and see what's next. Well, you know what? They come up. They say, we had a really good time at dinner. Why don't we go see a movie? There's this new movie out. We don't have to tell anybody. We'll just go see a movie, maybe grab some dinner after. And so that's what we do. We go see a movie and we go grab some dinner. What happens? Nothing. Nothing happened, right? We just grabbed a movie and got some dinner. And so then next we decide, you know what? The person's like, hey, maybe you should come over to my house for dinner. Maybe you should come to my house for dinner. It's more intimate, closer. You know, you're friends. Everything's going to be okay. So we go to the house for dinner. What happens? Nothing, right? We grab dinner. Now I'm looking at this cup. There's a lot of stress going on right here, right? And so a lot of us, we're getting to a place now where all of you are getting nervous. You're like, where is he going with this? What's going to happen? So then we go to the house for dinner, and then next thing you know, somebody wants you to go upstairs. They invite you to go upstairs. Now, I'm stopping here. We're not going any farther, okay? So they invite you to go upstairs. Well, what happens? You know, well, nothing's going to happen, but then all of a sudden, what happens? Now we find ourselves at a point of disrepair. See, this is impossible to come back from. This cup's never going to look the same. I don't care if you got the best artist in the world to put this back together and to glue it back together and to paint it. It's not going to look the same. Now, I didn't say it was unforgivable because we know that God can forgive and God is the great artist and he's the potter and he can do things with us and our broken pieces and make us into something new. But here's the thing. God doesn't want you to get to this point. So he wants us to build guardrails in our life. Because it is so much harder to come back from this. And that's what God's trying to teach us. That's why it's important. You see, we look at guardrails and we go, what am I missing out on? What am I missing? I don't want to miss out on that in my life. And God's saying, if you build the guardrail, there's some other things I have for you in your life that are so much greater. If you will just put this up, you could have a strong marriage and a strong relationship. You could be out of debt and pay off your house. All of these things could be yours if you will build the guardrails inside of your life. But see, we instead decide to flirt with disaster and we find ourselves in this place of disrepair. And so I believe that we need to understand that the reason that guardrails are inside of our life is to keep us from the danger zone. It's not about what we're going to miss out on. It's to keep us on the road and the path that God has for us. I want to share a story with you guys out of the book of Daniel. We're going to be in chapter 1. We've got a lot of scripture to read, so I may paraphrase some of this and kind of storytell, but it's going to be on the screen so you guys can kind of see where that's at. But we're in Daniel chapter 1, and we're starting in verse 1. And so just to kind of lay the groundwork, we're talking about a king by the name of Nebuchadnezzar. So some of you have heard of him before. So he's king of the Babylonian Empire. And here's what the king did. So the king had kind of decided and figured out that in conquering other countries, he had two options. Most of the time, people in that day, when they conquered a country, they enslaved all the people, and then they took over their land. That was kind of the model in which things happened. Well, this king realized that probably not everybody in the land were idiots. There was probably some smart people. There was probably some beautiful people. There's probably some people with good abilities. And so he said, you know what? Those people in those countries are most likely in nobility, and they're probably in the king's court. So when we overtake these countries, this is what I want to do. I want you to grab all the nobility, and I want you to grab the best of the best from the king's court, and I want you to bring them back to Babylon, and we're going to re-educate them. We're going to teach them about Babylonian culture and politics. We're going to teach them our diet. We're going to tell them all of these different things. And then we'll be able to send them back out, and we'll have these smart and amazing people, and we will be the strongest empire in the world. And if we look back on it, that's a really good strategy. And so he understood the power behind this, and so that's kind of where we're at. And so it says that in the third year of the reign of Jehoiakim, king of Judah, Nebuchadnezzar, king of Babylon, came to Jerusalem and besieged it. And the Lord delivered Jehoiakim, king of Judah, into his hands, along with some of the articles from the temple of God. These he carried off to the temple of his God in Babylonia and put the treasure of the house of his God. And then the king ordered Asenophaz. Now, I don't know where they came up with these names. Let's just take a second, okay? I don't know what they were thinking when they named their kids this, okay? I have no idea. Maybe it made sense back then. But he was the chief of his court officials, and to bring in to the king's service some of the Israelites from the royal family and the nobility. So they're doing what we just talked about inside of the nation of Israel. And so young men without any physical defect, handsome, showing aptitude for every kind of learning, well-informed, quick to understand, and qualified to serve in the king's palace. He was to teach them the language and the literature of the Babylonians. And the king assigned them a daily amount of food and wine from the king's table. And they were to be trained for 3 years. And after that, they were to enter the king's service. And so what the men that we're about to talk about, we know them as Daniel, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, okay? They had some different names, and they got renamed, so we will kind of skip over that point, but they received Babylonian names, but their names were Daniel, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. And so in this story, these men have been taken captive, and now they're in the king's court. All of their friends and family are enslaved. Okay, and they're being brought to a place where they are in the highest seat. They're at the king's palace. They get to eat the king's food. They get the nicest clothes. They get all of these things. And we're about to see Daniel make a decision to do something that is just unheard of. And so it tells us that they were assigned this amount of food. And then it tells us in verse 8, but Daniel resolved not to defile himself with the royal food and wine. And he asked the chief official for permission not to defile himself this way. Now, just for a second, understand the weight of what Daniel just did. Okay? Daniel just stood up to a king who has brought him in, has given him the best of the best, has set him apart from everyone else. And he says this to his overseer. He says, hey, I don't want to defile myself with this. Now, he didn't just say, I don't want to eat it. He didn't just say, I don't want that food. He said, I don't want to defile myself with this. So he's taking a bold step to say, look, enough's enough. I see where this is going. I'm not doing this. I'm not going to defile myself. And this is what this part here just amazes me. And it says that he asked to not defile himself with the royal food and wine. And he asked the chief official for permission not to defile himself this way. And verse 9 starts out this way. Now God had caused the official to show favor and compassion to Daniel. I want you to understand, there's a factor inside of all of our lives that we need to understand is there when we build guardrails. There's the now God factor. See, when you make a decision to say, I'm putting a guardrail up in my life, enough is enough, I'm not going past this point, God begins to do stuff on the back end for you because this is who God is. See, God is rooting for you. Some of us think God is somehow up there ruling with an iron fist, but God is rooting for you. He wants you to be successful in your life. He wants great things for you. And so when you decide to build the guardrail to say, I'm not going to go past this point, I'm not going to do these things in my life, there's the now God factor because he's going to begin to work things inside of your life that only he can do. So as we continue in verse 10, it says that the official told Daniel, I'm afraid of my lord the king who has assigned your food and drink. Why should he see you looking worse than the other young men your age? The king would then have my head because of you. So Daniel then said to the guard, this is a different person. Daniel said to the guard, whom the chief official had appointed over Daniel, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. They're, right now, they're known as different names. He said, please test your servant for 10 days. Give us nothing but vegetables to eat and water to drink. Then compare our appearance with that of the young men who eat the royal food and treat your servants in according with what you see. So he agreed to this and tested them for 10 days. So I'm a little bit of an imagination in this story, but what I'm thinking is that this overseer, because God had allowed him to have favor for Daniel, he probably had a little wink-wink conversation with the guard. It's like, I can't do this. You can. You know what I mean? Like, it was like, hey, I'm going to leave. As far as I'm concerned, I've told them no. Take it up with your guard. And so Daniel talks to the guard, and the guard says, okay, we'll do this for 10 days. After 10 days, though, if you're not healthier, if you're weaker, then you're going back on this diet, and nobody's going to know this ever happened, okay? And so he allows them to kind of walk into this. And here's what we read in verse 15. At the end of the 10 days, they looked healthier and better nourished than any of the young men who ate the royal food. So the guard took away their choice food and the wine they were to drink and gave them vegetables instead. And to these four young men, listen to this, God gave. See, they drew a line in the sand. They set up a guardrail. They said, we're not going past that. And so God gave them knowledge and understanding of all kinds of literature and learning. And Daniel could understand visions and dreams of all kinds. See, when we set up a guardrail in our life, God does something amazing. He directs and protects us. And so it says that the king talked with them and he found none equal to Daniel. Hananiah, Mishael, and Azariah, that's Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. So they entered the king's service, and in every matter of wisdom and understanding about which the king questioned them, he found them 10 times better than all the magicians and enchanters in his whole kingdom. What's the power in this? See, when we decide to put a guardrail in our life, we give God the ability to do something amazing inside of our lives. Because now we've decided, oh, I'm not going to do that. I'm not going to veer off. I can see where that's going. I can look down that ravine, and I know that's not a good place to be. And so we put the guardrail in our life, and God says, you know what? Now I can direct you. I can protect you. And in fact, I can set you up for greater things than you ever could imagine. See, I don't believe for a second that Daniel had any clue what was in his future when he made this decision. What he did know is what it was in his future if he didn't make the decision. And see, a lot of us, that's where we're at. We can look at our life right now and we can go, if I don't make a decision to change, if I don't put a guardrail up, I know where this is going to lead. Some of you, it's inside of your marriage. You say, if I don't put a guardrail up now, I know where this is going because I've seen it happen. I've seen what culture does to people when this goes on. For a lot of us, maybe it's our relationship with our children. Maybe we're not spending enough time at home because we're working too much, trying to make the right amount of money. And so we look at our life and we can see where it's going to end up. We're going to be distanced from our children. We're not going to have a personal relationship with them. They're not going to talk to us when they're in high school. They're going to go off to a college so far away so they don't have to communicate with us. And what's going to happen? We're going to look back 20 years from now and go, if I had to build a guardrail in my life, I wouldn't be down the path that I'm in. You see, that's what Daniel did. Daniel resolved. It tells us that he resolved that he was not going to do this. And so when we look at this, see, Daniel didn't know about the lion's den. He didn't know about the foretelling of dreams. He didn't know about saving a nation. He didn't know about any of this. He didn't know that years later we would read the story of his faithfulness to God in the lion's den and know about the miraculous power of God to save him from that moment. He didn't know about any of that. He just knew that he had a decision to make. Because he knew where it was going to end up if he didn't do the right thing. And so I think that we need to look at that today and go, what is it that we need to do? Maybe we know we're headed for a bad situation. You see, that's the amazing thing about guardrails. When we pull up next to a guardrail and we look over it, we can all see what we're headed into, right? We can all see what's going to happen if we go over that guardrail or through that guardrail or around that guardrail. And so if we know what lies in the danger zone, why do we try so hard to get there? See, we somehow have this thought that grass is greener on the other side, that it looks better over there. It's going to be great. I don't want to miss out. I don't want to miss out. I like what I'm doing. I like going into debt. It's great. I get new stuff all the time. It's amazing. I want to get to that point. But the reality is, God's like, if you put up some guardrails, I've got something so much better. You're going to be able to give more than you ever could give. You're going to be able to save more than you ever could save. But you've got to build this guardrail inside of your life. See, we have to remember this. Regardless of whether you have guardrails or not, the tension is not going away. See, if Daniel wouldn't have made the decision right then and right there to do what he did, at some point he'd have put the brakes on. He'd have had to realize, and it'd have been so much harder to come back from. But because he chose that moment to say, this is where I'm putting it in, this is where I'm building the guardrail, we see what God was able to do inside of our life. In Proverbs 11:3, it says this. It says, the integrity of the upright guides them, but the unfaithful are destroyed by their duplicity. See, integrity is strong morals. An upright means a person who has strong morals. So when we decide to have strong morals, to build guardrails, to make these things, that's going to be what guides us in our life. That allows God to be able to direct us and to protect us from the things in this world and what culture's telling us. But if we don't and we're unfaithful, then we are destroyed. And so we have to understand the power in that. We have to choose what is right. See, a guardrail is a personal standard of behavior that becomes a matter of conscience. See, when Daniel made that decision, it became a personal standard. He wasn't ever going back from it. And we see that later in his life when he decides, when he's told you shouldn't pray during this time, what does he do? He prays because he's made it a standard of personal behavior. He says, I'm going to do this because I believe it's right, because I know this is what God's called me to do. This is a guardrail in my life. See, if you're so easy to just sway over the things in your life that you know you're not supposed to do, it's not a guardrail. It's a painted line. A guardrail becomes a barrier that goes, nope, I'm not going to do that. We bump up against it and we know, oh, that's not safe for me. I shouldn't be in this situation. This isn't where I should be. You have no idea what God wants to do with your life. You have no idea. And see, sometimes that's the battle that we face because we can see where the other road leads. We can see where the other road's going to head. But living a life after God, putting up guardrails, means us trusting and having faith that God's going to direct the way and he's going to protect us throughout it. So we have to trust God in those moments and go, you know what? I don't know what the future holds, but I know if I put this guardrail up in my life that God's going to be able to direct and to protect me from whatever it is that lies ahead. As we close today and we begin to end this series, the band's going to come and we're going to sing a song and take some time just to pray, but I want to encourage you during this time to just look at your life and where is it that you need to put a guardrail? Every single one of us in our life, in this room, myself included, have guardrails that we need to put into place. Doesn't matter how old you are or how young you are, there's things that God wants to do in your life, and he wants you to build some guardrails. And each and every one of us, I want us to take some time this morning during this song and just to reflect on where are we at inside of our life, what is God doing, and what is he asking us to do? What guardrails is he asking us to build? If you would stand to your feet, I want everyone in the room just to bow your head and close your eyes. We're going to take some time to pray. But I want to encourage you during this time to really look at what it is that God's wanting you to change. What changes does he want you to make? Because here's the thing, all of us have a guardrail that we need to build in our life. Let's pray. Father God, as Lord, we just come to you today. And Lord, you know right where we're at. You know.